Wash all my sins away. Wash all. Good night, everybody. Pleasant evening to all of us. Let us all stand as we begin.
Welcome to Homes of Hope and Healing Evangelistic Campaign. We are thrilled that you are here. Here are a few guidelines to ensure an enjoyable stay with us. Parking.
Heavenly gracious Father, we come before you, thanking you for all what has transpired thus far. As we go through this service, and to us that you come here and dwell with us, that we have a pleasant service and a wonderful song service too. Begin in my prayer. Amen.
Amen. You may choose to stand, you may choose to sit, wherever you decide to give your worship this evening. We're just inviting you to give your best worship as we begin. Hallelujah, you have won the victory.
We'll be right back.
Kings.
Of Jesus' love, sing of Him. Ooh. tonight, church? I trust that everyone had a beautiful day today. I beg your endurance for the next 5 minutes as I do a session on health. For those of you who do not know who I am, my name is Kalma Louis, Senior Environmental Health Officer. This evening, our session is on the consumer guide to food safety. And every one of us here go to the supermarket, right? Every one of us buy. Good? That's a fact. Any one of us had experienced any foodborne illness? Either now or in the past? All right, you say no. But in reality, you may have gotten a foodborne illness and wasn't even aware of it. Because in Dominica, we do not report foodborne illnesses. When you get a foodborne illness, sometimes all you do is go home, drink some bush tea, and you think you're okay. And then most of the time, you blame your illness on Dowasco. Poor Dowasco that feeds or has a water catchment to feed a population that is so wide. Because they take it from all the way to Mero to all the way down to Wallhouse. So one or two persons have a foodborne illness and they say it's Dowasco. So I want to guide you with the few minutes that I have to encourage you when you go to the shop, what you need to look for. When you shop, do you purchase from a reputable food supplier? Do you look out for the food handler who is certified by the Environmental Health Department? How many people do that? The Environmental Health Department certifies all categories of food handlers. It is a requirement by law. When we certify those individuals, they would have gone through a health education session by the Environmental Health Department, after which they would have done a medical, and the doctor would see the person fit. They come back to us, and we certify the person for 1 year, and we give them a permit. How many of you look out for that little permit, whether it is red or green or purple, whatever your district is? We have colors to identify your district. And we do inspection for your meat that you eat. So you're purchasing meat from a butcher. Do you ask the butcher for the postmortem form that the Environmental Health gives? Or do you just purchase the cattle, the beef? How do you know that this meat is fit for consumption? How can you tell that the meat probably was just slaughtered without Environmental Health tried or died? It could have been because it was hung. Or probably a leg was broken and the person decided to kill that cattle and have it for sale and you buy it. You're not even sure. You need to ask the person for their permit or their postmortem form that we will give when we conduct an inspection of that meat. One other point. Buy cold food last and get it home fast. You know how we like to do it, eh? We buy the chicken solid, hard, well frozen. But we have that chicken at the back of the transport. We want to go up to Astafan's to get the detergent. And then we forget something by Fresh Market. We go down to Fresh Market. And then we move to Easter. And we continue to do our shopping and forget that meat or that cold food. Where bacteria can start to grow and multiply in that food after it has been left out in the temperature danger zone for how long. When you are shopping, be mindful of that. Be mindful that you have to take cold food home as quickly as possible. Make the cold food. If you know you have all those duvet to do in Roseau, let it be the last thing that you buy. If you do not have a cold chill bag, let that be the last thing that you purchase. Do not buy food in poor conditions. Papa Met, as an environmental health officer, I cannot tell certain people don't go there. But, I mean, we have eyes. And you can see the way the condition of the place, and you still go there and you buy. Look out for those places. Pay attention to where you're buying. Be a wise consumer. The environmental health officers cannot be in every place. So you have to be all eyes sometimes. When you get that information, I expect you to be different this evening. When you go out to buy, be a wise consumer. Look at the place. If there are pets, no cats should be in the food establishment. No children should be in the food establishment. And if you go there as a wise consumer and you see something like that, your money is in your pocket. You walk out with it and you look for a place that meeting those standards set by environmental health. Your canned foods. When you go to the supermarket, are you just checking on the ingredients of the food? Do you look for the canned food? There is something that is called date marking information. How many of you spend time at the supermarket checking out the cans? Checking out to see if there is a dent, if there is a rust, if it is bulgy. The use-by date. Do you know what the use-by date means? If you don't know, I am telling you. When you look at the package of the use-by food date, on that package, there's a crucial indicator related to safety. It signifies that the last day until which the product is considered safe for consumption. So that means the manufacturer is saying that the food best buy, that this is the time they can guarantee the wholesomeness of that food. After that date, they cannot tell you that you will get the nutritional value from that food anymore. So pay attention to that. All right? Best if used by or best before date. It indicates the last day on which the product is at its peak quality. All right? And your sell by date, a date guide that retailers indicating the date allowed displaying the food for sale. So the best by date tells you that today, the 8th of April, 2024, is the last date for the food to be on the shelf. You go to those supermarkets and you see some of those foods already on. You know you're not going to consume it, but you purchase it to bring it in your cupboard. You store it in your cupboard and you leave it there. That's a fact. You see them on the shelves and you take them. Yeah? You cannot. You're not sure what will happen to you within that time. So, and besides, you're not sure what is in that food that can cause a foodborne illness. And foodborne illness is dangerous. It is fatal. If you have never gotten a foodborne illness, ask a mother who is in childbearing. They say it is just as bad as bearing a child. And the expiry date. When you expired, that means you need pas bon. It's not good. Anything that expires is to do what? To throw. So why you purchase them? Why do you still go to the supermarket or when the bus is passing, you buy it from them? It expires. It's no longer good. All right? An absolute date marking guide that tells the food handler when a food is no longer safe for consumption. So my dear brethren, my dear brothers and sisters, the few minutes that I stood here, I hope that there is something you can take from this message. And I want to encourage you, when you're going shopping, to be a wise consumer. Remember, your health is your responsibility. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. I'm so happy to be associated with Home, Hope, and Healing. Tonight, I have that song by request. It's the question, are you a pretender? Don't pretend. Don't pretend that you are a believer. Don't pretend you have the Holy Spirit. Only the truth shall set you free. was no pretender shall ever enter in. Are you a pretender living in your sins? You need the Holy Spirit that you could be set free. Because no pretender shall ever enter in. So give your heart to the Savior. He'll save your soul from time. The kingdom is soon coming. Turn around, 'cause mercy door is closing. His loving children, they keep his commandments. 'Cause no pretender shall ever enter in. Are you a pretender living in your sins? You need the Holy Spirit that you could be set free. Because no pretender shall ever enter in. So give your heart to the Savior. Save your soul from sin. So give your heart to the Savior. He'll save your soul from sin. So give your heart to the Savior. He'll save your soul from sin. He'll save your soul from sin. Yeah.
Okay, good night. This moment, we are going to pick up the evening's offering. We are asking the ushers to take up their position. But before we do so, let us just bow heads for a word of prayer. Father Lord, we want to say thanks to you for another opportunity that we could be here tonight. Here we can sit at your feet and to listen to another portion of your word. We are thankful for the sacrifice that you have made on our behalf, and as a result, dear Lord, as of our gratitude, we want to return unto you an offering so that, Lord, that we can use it for the salvation of souls. So we pray, O God, that you bless the offerings, and at the end of it, dear Lord, save us, we pray, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen and amen.
I need a blessing, I need a blessing, I need a blessing, oh yeah. I need a blessing, I need a blessing, I need a blessing. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing.
It's coming down, it's coming down, it's coming down, 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 down. Well, good night, everybody. Ah, that's it. You know, I've been thinking a lot about you. And I've been praying about you. And I've been asking God that he will work a miracle in somebody's life. Because so very many of us need to be closer to Jesus Christ. Tonight, I would like to do something very special. We have a new brother. Was baptized last Sabbath. And he has asked for a special prayer tonight. I know there's a prayer tent out there, but he has requested. And so I'm going to ask you, my friend, come on up. Can I have two or three prayer warriors, if they're available, to come, please? Elders, if you're here, pastors, if you're here, come up. And I have not asked him for the specifics of his situation. But as I understand it, he wants us to pray about his health. And that is enough. So come over, my brother. I must tell Jesus all of my troubles. Let's make a circle around him. Hallelujah, tonight we are praying for health. And I'm going to ask Pastor Henry to take that prayer. Every muscle, every vein, every tissue.
I must tell Jesus all of my trials. I cannot bear these burdens alone. In my distress, he kindly will help me.
He ever loves and cares for his own. Come on, everybody, let's stand together and sing. I must tell Jesus.
I
cannot bear my burdens alone.
I must tell Jesus.
Jesus can help me. Jesus alone.
Jesus alone.
Amen. Loving God and Father, you are great. You are mighty. You are worthy to be praised. There is no name like your name. There is no rock like you, O Father. You are above and beyond our thinking. You have said that your ways are not our ways. Your thoughts are not our thoughts, O Heavenly Father. And so tonight, we know that you are a big God. You are a mighty God. And tonight, we understand that there is no case too small. There is no case too insignificant. There is no case too big for you, because you are a big God. And so tonight, in the mighty name of Jesus, we come on behalf of our brother, because we know that even faith as small as a mustard seed can move mountains, oh God. Faith as small as a mustard seed, oh God, can heal and restore the life of our brother. And so tonight, we come with the faith of a million mustard seed, and we pray that you touch Brother Tuse at this time, oh God. We pray that you heal him, mighty Father. And if there is anything that is preventing his health, oh God, if there is anything, oh God, if the enemy has his hand in his life, we come against him in Jesus' name, oh God. We pray that the gates of hell will not prevail, oh God. You will have the final say, because we declare that Brother Tuse is your son. He is your child. And tonight, in the mighty name of Jesus, with the faith of a million mustard seed, we declare our brother healed. even in our silence, right now, we pray that your Holy Spirit will begin to render healing to his body. And so tonight, in faith, thank you for healing Brother Tuse. In Jesus' name I pray.
Somebody say, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Be seated, please. Be seated. Be seated. Tonight, I would like to invite those in the back tent. There's a lot of space in the front tent. And I'd like to invite you, if you're so minded, come on up. Sit with us. Because we see some space up here. And everybody knows that the preacher likes to see the people in front of him. So if you're so minded, thanks. Some of you are moving. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. There's no shortage of space tonight at the front. So let's fill up the front, and don't want to make you uncomfortable, but I'm asking nicely, and I want to thank those who are responding. Come on up. Come on up. Step right in and have a seat. You know that song, Barry? Let's sing it. Step right in and have a seat. Come on up, join us in the front tent, everybody.
Step right in and have a seat. Step right in and have a seat. Step right in and have a seat. For the evening train will be soon. Step right in and have a seat. Step right in and have a seat.
Oh, step
right in.
Going up.
We are going up on the morning train. We are going up on the morning train. We are going up on the morning train for the evening.
And for the last time, step right in and have a seat.
Step right in and have a seat.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So I want to get straight to the word tonight and see how soon I can get you out of here. Tonight's message is entitled, I know we haven't sung it yet, Shaking My Head. I want to make sure we have this screen before we go there. Do I have it? Just to make sure. Is it good? I know when we come at nights, we have some issues. So just give me a single. Yes, it's good. All right. So we're going to stand and sing the theme song. By the power of your love. Let's go. Lord, I come to you.
Lord, I come to you.
Let my heart be changed.
Let my heart be changed.
Renewed. Flowing from the grace that I've found in you. Come on, everybody. And Lord, I've come to know.
Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away.
The power of your love. Can I see your hands tonight as we sing the song of Hold Me Close?
Hold takes me on by the power of your love. Lord, unveil my eyes. Let me see you face to face.
The knowledge of your love. Renew my mind. Everybody, let's go together. Oh God, we thank you again for bringing us together to worship you. Somebody in this place tonight, oh God, needs you more than ever before. And we are praying tonight that you will step out of these sacred pages of history and step into the hearts and lives of men. Save people tonight, oh God, I pray. In Jesus' precious name. Kindly be seated, everybody. Yes, yes, yes. So tonight's topic, shaking my head. SMH, shaking my head. Praise the Lord. Are you ready? Allegorian, are you there?
Oh, yes, preacher.
Let's get it together tonight. So I want to begin the message tonight by pointing out to you, as I've done on many nights before, that I'm trying to keep pace with the young people and the way in which they speak, especially when it relates to the internet and internet slang. And I've been able to discover that there are lots of abbreviations that the young people use. And one of them is SMH. Stands for shaking my head. I looked it up online and I discovered that in texting and writing, SMH stands for shake my head or shaking my head. The term expresses a person's disappointment or bafflement regarding a specific topic or a piece of information. For example, if someone says something ridiculous or outrageous or makes some activity or behavior that is far beyond belief, a person may respond with the letters SMH, shaking my head, which means I am totally amazed at what this person just said. I am totally amazed at what this person just did. I am totally amazed and disappointed at this person's expression. Are you still listening to me tonight? I am amazed at how often people hearing the word of God can feel his power, sense his presence, feel that they are being saved and still turn their backs on God. I am amazed. And it leaves me shaking my head. Is anybody hearing me tonight? Let's get straight to the scripture. Mark chapter 10 and verse 17. Let's read out loud with Brother Gorin. Everybody reading together tonight. What does the Bible say?
And when he was gone forth into the way,
what happened?
There came one running
and
kneeled to him
and asked him the question,
good master,
what
shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?
If you recall last night, I mentioned this story of the rich young ruler. The background to this story is that Jesus was on the mountainside in the streets teaching the people about God. And they asked him about the kingdom of heaven. And my Bible says that Jesus took a child and placed that child in the midst of them and then declared, except you all become as this little child, you shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. Are you listening to me tonight? A child is humble. A child is simple. A child accepts and believes almost anything that is told to it. And the Bible is saying that we must not be gullible. We must not be impressionable. But when God speaks to us, we must have a childlike faith that accepts a doth saith the Lord. As long as we know God is speaking, we should be willing to accept whatever God is saying.
Amen.
Let me know that you're hearing me tonight. Now watch this, watch this, watch this. Apparently the man was so impressed by what Jesus said and what Jesus did that he could not keep quiet. And so the Bible says, as Jesus was leaving the object lesson involving the child, the man ran after him, stopped him in the rear, knelt down in his presence, and asked him the question, Lord, I hear you talking about the kingdom of heaven. I heard when you spoke about eternal life. But Lord, I feel that I'm not there yet. So I've stopped by to ask you a simple question. What must I do to get this eternal life? Are you hearing me tonight?
Oh, yes.
Well, let's work with it. Now, the book of Luke tells us what, Brother Gorin, about this man. He was what?
A ruler.
And as a ruler, he had power.
Oh, for sure.
He had authority. Now, we know what rulers are like. They are our presidents. They are our prime ministers. They are our politicians. And if you live in Europe, your ruler may even be a king. And very often, rulers may feel that they are above and beyond everybody else. But whether you are high or you are low, whether you are rich or you are poor, whether you are male or you are female, whether you are Bajan or you are Dominican, I don't care what status you have tonight. The Bible says that the rich and the poor must equally be born again.
Preach it, minister.
There is no special treatment for rich people in the kingdom of God. Because at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow.
Oh, yes.
And every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. Whether you are rich or ruler or poor or beggar, everybody must meet the same standard in order to be saved.
Praise his name.
If that was not true, rich people would buy their way into heaven.
For sure.
And poor people would be left out. But I thank the good Lord that it isn't so. For the rich and the poor together must go.
I don't care what degree you have, where you have studied, what's your job status, what house you live in, what parish or village you are from. It does not matter with God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and you have got to repent.
That's the work.
The book says he was a ruler, but that doesn't matter with God. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John states that he was rich.
Oh, yes.
Money doesn't matter with God. Because God says, I have cattle on 1,000 hills. He may have 1,000 cattle on each hill. Are you listening to what I'm saying? So we cannot impress God with our money, with our status, with our power or our authority. God is only impressed by the blood of Jesus Christ. And tonight, everybody should be like this rich, young ruler. What must I do to get it? Because this is something that comes to us from without ourselves. Nobody can brag about their goodness, for all our righteousness is as filthy rags. Nobody can think they're better than anybody else. We're all the same in the eyes of God. In heaven's eyes, there are no losers. In heaven's eyes, no helpless cause. Only people like me and you needing Jesus Christ. And we're amazed by the grace that we find in heaven's eyes.
Hallelujah.
Everybody should be asking tonight, Brother Goring, what must I do
to be saved?
To have eternal life.
Oh, yes.
Are you watching me? So as a rich man, he had what?
Possession.
And as a young man, he had what?
Potential and possibility.
But let me back up a little bit here to tell you that a person's riches can leave them.
True.
In a very short space of time.
Absolutely.
Especially if you are investing on the money market. And getting involved in modern investments is a risky thing. A person can be wealthy today and the money is gone in a minute. And then that which on which you depend for your status and for your bling and for the way you live is gone.
True talk.
The Bible says he was young. And there are a lot of young people up in this world wasting their time.
True.
They feel they have time to come to God.
True.
They feel they can wait. There's a tomorrow. Tomorrow? Forget about tomorrow. Won't you choose the Lord today?
Oh,
for yes, tomorrow may very well be too late.
Too late.
How many people have left home in the morning and have not returned home in the afternoon? How many people have gone down the street unsuspectingly to meet an accident? Do not put your trust and confidence in youth, because in Barbados, grandma used to say, yellow limes as well as green limes are falling. I think she meant to suggest both the older and the young are dying, and nobody knows when it's their time. So live for Jesus.
Amen.
That's what matters. Are you hearing me tonight? Riches can be taken away. Youth can be lost. And all your potential and possibilities go down the drain. As a ruler, he had pleasure and he had power. Possessions, possibilities, power mean nothing with God.
True.
Read it for me, Brother Goring. What does it say there? If you have riches,
if
you can
you have
what?
Riches, you can lose them.
Uh-huh. And if you have fame,
it can fly away.
And if you have a name,
someone can stain it.
But,
come on.
If you have Jesus. Somebody say Jesus.
Amen. Jesus.
Somebody shout Jesus.
Jesus.
If you have Jesus.
You have everything, preacher.
You have everything. Now, there are a lot of people who don't believe that. Because they have not had an experience where God has done anything for them. That's what they say. They do not realize that I've got a feeling in my head. And it's keeping me alive. Y'all know that song? Jesus
is keeping me alive. I do not have to think to breathe. I do not have to think for my blood to circulate. I do not have to think for my lungs to take in air. Jesus is keeping me alive. He gives me the water that I drink, the food that I eat, the clothes on my back. He may not give me everything I want, but he gives me everything I need. And even though I have problems in my life, I stand with Job. I know that my Redeemer liveth.
Yes,
and he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though worms shall eat this skin of mine, I know that in my flesh I shall see God.
That's the word, preacher.
Even though he slays me, yet will I trust him.
Trust him.
Because in the midst of tribulation and problems, our God has said, I will never, never, never,
never,
never, never leave you or forsake you.
Yes, sir.
No, not you will I ever forsake. No, not you will I ever leave. I thank God that despite a rainy day, I know he is sufficient. I know he is enough. I know his grace lifts me up. I know that every day with Jesus gets sweeter than the day before.
Hallelujah.
And so I want to tell young people, don't walk away from God. There are too many young people walking away from God.
True, preacher.
It's a trick of the devil. You are here in this world because of the goodness and grace and mercy of God.
Oh, yes.
Do not turn your back on God. It's what the devil wants. For when you step out and you are off base, it's when the devil attacks you. Stay with God. A lot of young people allow the devil to trick them. They go after popularity. They go after fame. They go after money. Are you still listening to what I'm saying? And they go after the things of this world. They want to be a part of the do. But I have seen what the world does with people. The pledges of the world. The promises of the world. The so-called gifts and blessings of the world. They do not last. Like Esau, we give away our birthright for the immediate pleasure of a bowl of lentil soup. There is something better. Have a little patience. And God will bring it to pass. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Young people, stay with God. Stay with God. Now, eternal life is mentioned how many times in the scriptures, Brother Goring?
41 times in scripture.
According to my check. Huh? Now, something is wrong with my slide there. Those numbers don't add up. But I know it's 41 times. All right? I think it's twice in the Old Testament, and it should now be what? 39 times in the New.
Oh, yes.
All right, so I've corrected that. So do not go home and say, what the pastor talking about? That's an error in copying and pasting or typing. And I apologize profusely for it.
Accept it, preacher.
Do I have your forgiveness?
Oh, yes.
I'm but human after all. So it is found 41 times in the scripture. Some in the old, very few, but many in the New Testament.
Yes, sir.
When it is used, it is always in reference to conversion and the new birth. The new birth means that a man is born of the Spirit and born of water. I want you to know that the rich young ruler asked Jesus, what must I do to be saved? If he were under a tent in Mahaut, Dominica, he would be walking up to the altar at the end of the service, and he would be taking the preacher's hand and coming on to the platform, signaling that he is asking the question, what must I do to be saved? He is ready to raise his hand at the appeal. He's ready to sign the card.
Oh, yes.
He's ready to walk down the aisle. He's ready to come upon the platform. He's ready to say, Lord, I will follow you, but not so fast. Jesus has something to say about it. He had the right motive. What else did he have, brother?
The right attitude.
What else did he have?
He asked the right question.
And he came to the right
source.
Now, if you want to know how to get salvation, you go to Jesus. Hear what I
tell
you?
Oh, yes. For sure.
Don't even come to me. Go to Jesus. I am a preacher of what the Bible says, but there is nothing significant or important about me if I do not point people to Jesus. And there are too many church leaders accepting glory and honor in the positions they occupy, which don't belong to them. No minister of the gospel is God. None of us are righteous. All of us must be pointing people to Jesus Christ. So if you want salvation, go to Jesus. Do not come to me to forgive any sins. Do not come to me to make any confessions. Do not come to me for any absolution. Come to me. I'll pray with you. I'll lift you up in prayer. I'll encourage you. I'll counsel you. And together we will go to Jesus.
Amen.
And there's nobody in between us and Jesus. The Bible says, come boldly now to the throne of grace and find help in a time of need. There's nothing between my soul and the Savior. I don't need any intermediaries. The Bible says there's one God.
Oh, yes.
And one mediator between God and man.
Hallelujah.
And that person is Jesus. We can go straight to Jesus. We don't need anybody else. Are you hearing me tonight? All right, let's hurry on. This rich young ruler, in my opinion, was an almost Christian. Have you all ever seen The Almost Christian? Huh? Now, don't call anybody's name or anything like that. We're not judging, but we are making a point tonight. He was and I'll tell you why I know he was an almost Christian. He was near there, but he wasn't there yet. And Jesus had to point that out to him. Now, Judas Iscariot was an almost Christian.
Yes, sir.
He followed Jesus for 3.5 years. And he kept the bag in the treasury. But at the end of the time, when the crunch time came, Judas betrayed Jesus for pieces of silver.
True.
And because of guilt, because of shame, because of regret, the Bible says Judas went out and hung himself. He was an almost Christian.
Yes, sir.
How can a person walk with God in the presence of God himself for 3.5 years, eat at his table, drink from his cup, shake his hand, recline on his breast, have many a conversation with God, and then betray him? Judas was an almost Christian. Demas was an almost Christian. You all know him? Luke talks about Demas. Paul is in prison. And he sends to Timothy and say, bring my books and my coat. Come before winter. He says, everyone else has left me. This person has gone to Croatia. That person has gone to Athens. Only Demas is with me now. But we never read anything more about Demas because the Bible says in another portion, even Demas has left me. Peter was an almost Christian until he got it all together on the beach in Galilee when Jesus said to him, do you love me more than these? He became an altogether Christian then.
Amen.
King Agrippa, who I will tell you about tonight, was also an almost Christian. In Acts chapter 26, he tells Paul, I am almost persuaded. Let's take a look at the background. Paul was arrested in the temple. He was tried by Felix, and he was left in prison for 2 years. Anybody following what I'm saying? Let's pick up the story in Acts 24:24. Brother Goring, read out loud. Everybody with the reader, what does the Bible say?
And after certain days,
that's 2 years,
when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, which was a Jewess,
he sent for
Paul
and heard him.
concerning the faith in Christ.
Now let's keep on reading. And as he reasoned of what?
Righteousness.
And
temperance.
And
judgment to come.
Felix did what?
Trembled.
So Paul was speaking about God. And the response of the judge is that he trembled. And he answered. What did he say to Paul?
Go thy way. For this time.
Yes.
When I have a convenient season, I will call for thee.
The word of God comes to every man. Perhaps it comes to a preacher called Hall. A short, bald-headed, black, intelligent fella from Barbados.
Come on, preacher.
No, I'm not going to leave out the intelligent part. And the gospel of Christ comes to you.
Yes, sir.
And you say to the preacher, but more importantly, you say to God, it is not a convenient time. Carnival is coming up. It is not the season in which I wish to repent. I'm making money. I'm having women. I'm having a good time. It's just not convenient. Well, I want to say to such people tonight, it was not convenient for Christ to be nailed on the cross.
True.
It was not convenient for the God of heaven, who excels his creation, to become a human being and live among us. The night on which he was born, there was no room. Born in a stable, wrapped in swaddling clothes, the King of heaven was not worried about convenience. Grew up in Galilee, grew up in Nazareth. People criticized him and his family. Is this not Joseph's boy? The bastard boy. The boy who does not have a father. His mother pretends and says that what she got was from the Holy Spirit. But this boy does not know who his father is. Born or raised rather in a city that had no acclaim. Raised in a village that people looked down upon and said, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? It was not convenient. It wasn't convenient that he would walk around Galilee in sandals and pick up dust on his feet. He would have to say to his disciples, foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. He did not have a mortgage. He did not own a home. He did not have any permanent place of abode. It was not convenient. Are you understanding what I'm saying to you tonight? When I think about the goodness of God and all that he has done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah, thank God for saving me. Came down here, people spat in his face, poke a spear in his side, crown of thorns on his head, nails in his hands and feet, mocked him and scorned him. The King of the universe submitted to the human mob. It was not convenient. It was not easy, but he did it for you, and he did it for me. And now all he asks is, child, give me your heart. And your response is going to be, come back when it's more convenient. Are you hearing me, church?
Oh, yes, preacher.
There are some of you up in here tonight who are saying that to God. The time is not right. You've come at a bad time, God. Come back at a more convenient season. I will call for you. Now, Felix had it wrong. People don't call for God. God calls people. And people's response must be to get right with God. You cannot tell God when to move, how to move, what to do. You've just got to be ready that he moves. So better go and read that last statement again. What did Felix tell Paul? Huh?
Go thy way for this time.
And when I have what?
A convenient season.
I will
call for thee.
Now let me tell you, there are many people who have said that to me. and they do not live to make that call.
Mercy.
Are y'all hearing me tonight? There's so many people who thought that they could have gone and come back. They do not get back.
True.
I am saying to anybody in here tonight who needs to make it right with God, stop taking chances. The only safe place is to be in the arms of Jesus.
Absolutely.
By the time this sermon is done, I'm going to tell you a couple of stories to illustrate that point. Stories that I experienced with people as a pastor. There's no problem telling the stories because all of these people are dead. But I will tell you the stories tonight. Felix is fearful because as Paul preaches and teaches and speaks, his heart is being moved by the Spirit of God. But yet he is delaying his response. Felix was moved by the first hearing of the gospel, but delay made his heart grow cold to the truth. The longer you resist, the longer you put it off, the easier it becomes for you to put it off again. Procrastination, we are told, in modern parlance, is a thief of time. Procrastination before obeying shows that something else is priority for us.
Yes, sir.
Now, let me tell you why I have that idea. I'm coming to it. Now, Paul was arrested in the temple, tried by Felix, and left in prison for 2 years. Festus tried Paul, but he appealed to Caesar. Festus asked King Herod Agrippa II to hear the appeal. So Paul goes into the court of appeal in Acts 25 and 26. In Acts 26, verse 1 to 3, Paul asked for an impartial hearing. In Acts 26, 4 to 11, Paul speaks about his upbringing away from God. He speaks about his conversion. And he speaks about his hope and the hope of the Jews in Jesus Christ, the Messiah. He speaks so fervently about the vision he received from Jesus on the road to Damascus and how God had commissioned him. Paul, go into the highways and hedges and compel men to come to Jesus. He spoke about his commitment. He spoke about his experiences. And then he said to Agrippa, my conduct was beyond reproach. Then God called, I obeyed. He says, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision. Are you still with me, church? That's what he said. Now watch this, watch this. Listen to what else he said to Agrippa. Acts 26, 27, 29. Everybody out loud with the reader. What does this one say?
King Agrippa.
Slowly.
Believest thou the prophet?
That's a big question. Agrippa, do you believe the word of God? And then Paul does not wait for an answer. Continue reading, Brother Green.
I know that thou believest.
Uh-huh. Then Agrippa said to Paul,
almost thou persuadest me.
What's that A word, everybody?
Almost.
Almost thou do what?
Persuadest me to be a Christian.
Now the first fellow, Felix, says, I'm not ready now. Come back at a more convenient time. The crusade should not have been March and April. Anytime during October, I'll be ready.
Mercy.
And now Agrippa says to Paul, boy, you're good. Hall, you're good. Hall, you can preach up a storm. You almost persuaded me.
Mercy.
To be a Seventh-day Adventist. Paul, I'm almost persuaded to become a Christian. I want to say to you tonight, almost is totally lost.
True. True talk, preacher.
There is no middle ground. You are either saved or you're lost. You're either for Jesus or you're for Satan.
True.
Jesus says, if you do not gather with me, you are scattering abroad. There is no walking in the middle of the road. Make up your minds.
Are you on God's side? Are you on Satan's side?
Elijah gave the people a choice on Mount Carmel. He says, how long halt you between two opinions? Did you ever read that? Now, the word halt is an image that is military, and it's an image that is lame. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? How long halt you between two opinions? Military people know that every time you halt, it is one, two, three. Is anybody alive to what I'm saying tonight?
Oh, yes, preacher.
There is a pause between the steps. And the Hebrew word that is translated halt means how long will you pause between the steps? If God is God, then serve him. But if Baal is God, then serve him. Jehovah or Baal. Jehovah or but make up your mind.
Make up your mind.
Because
preacher.
No man can serve
two masters.
Are you hearing me tonight?
Oh, yes, preacher.
It is not only a military image, it's a lame image. It predicts or exposes a person who walks with a limp, a firm step, and a wobble step. Now, I don't mean to make fun of anybody who is differently able. I'm illustrating the scriptures. And if you read the Hebrew, you will see what I'm saying. It means to limp. It means to pause. How long will you pause between two steps? If it is Jehovah, serve him. But if it is Baal, serve him. Is it Jehovah or is it Baal? How long? Joshua said, I tell you today, I am placing before you life and death. Choose life, that it may be well with you and your household. And if it seem evil to serve the Lord, then don't serve him. But as for me and my house.
Yes, sir. Preacher of righteousness. Go ahead now.
People have to make up their minds.
Oh, yes.
They want their cake and eat it too.
Wow.
You are either in the world or you're in the church.
True.
You cannot be in both. You cannot be in the dance hall and the church hall.
No, sir.
How did Paul respond to Agrippa?
And Paul said, I would to God
that
not only thou, but also all that hear me
today
were both almost
and altogether
such as I am.
In other words, Christians. Paul said, don't be almost, be total.
Total.
So King Agrippa is almost, but still lost.
Mercy.
He knew what Paul was saying was true. He believed what Paul was saying concerning the facts relating to Jesus. Faith which does not obey is not enough.
Not enough, preacher.
Now, people tell me they believe in God. Believing in God is not enough.
Not enough.
What do I mean by that? Because last night I told you all you have to do is believe. So what do I mean by that? When you believe and accept Jesus, he comes into your heart. And if you are honest about it, you are saved immediately. It's called justification.
Oh, yes. Justification.
It's a first step.
For sure.
God forgives you. God cleanses you. God washes you. And God declares you righteous.
Hallelujah.
It is at that point in time when you accept Christ that you can be baptized. But as the days come and go, the scripture says we now have to walk in newness of life.
For sure.
We have to walk in righteousness. And every day with Jesus is supposed to get better and sweeter than the day before. The knowledge you had yesterday must grow. The patience you had yesterday must grow. The temperance you had yesterday must grow. Your faith must grow. Your experience must grow. You cannot stay as you are. When you come, there's more land to conquer.
Preach it, minister. Strong word.
Are you hearing me?
Oh, yes.
So people are invited to take additional steps. You believe. And belief brings you to the place where you say, God, what is it now else that I must do? In fact, that is what the rich young ruler was saying. Because he believed. But he was still asking God, what now? What next? This is the question I'm trying to answer tonight. King Agrippa, the almost Christian but still lost. Here's the principle. If you know truth and continue in sin, God cannot forgive you. Are you hearing me tonight?
Oh, yes, preacher.
Hebrews 10, 26 to 31 says, after we have come to a knowledge of truth and we go back into error, there remains no sacrifice for sins. Let me explain what I'm saying. If you come to God, he forgives you. He accepts you. He says, come as you are. But he never said, stay as you are.
Strong point. Come on, preacher.
So when you come to Christ, there must be change.
For sure.
Your attitude must change.
Oh, yes.
Your behavior must change.
Absolutely.
Your clothes must change.
Definitely.
The places I used to go, I go there no more.
No more.
There's a great change since I was born. So I keep out of worldly places of amusement. Places where God is not honored. Places where God is not lifted up. I stay away from such places. Because I'm uniting my life with God and I'm going on a different trajectory. But if we remain in the same place where God met us, there's no progress. There's no growth.
True.
Didn't Jesus say to Mary Magdalene, go and sin no more?
Yes, sir.
So liars must speak the truth.
True.
And thieves must stop stealing.
Definitely.
Drunkards must get sober.
Oh, yes, preacher.
Wife beaters must become wife lovers.
Go ahead now.
People who are filled with worldly pleasure must now seek God's pleasure. There must be a change. You see, the Bible declares that the formula for salvation is faith and obedience. Romans chapter 6, verse 17. Let's read from 1 John 5, Brother Gorin. Everybody with the reader, what does the Bible say?
And this is the record.
This is the what, everybody?
Record.
Uh-huh, that what?
That God had given to us eternal life.
And this life is in
his son.
Now the rich young ruler was in this place. He had found out that Jesus was the Son of God. He believed. So he had received Christ. He believed and he followed and he ran. And he said, good master, he acknowledged Christ. What must I do to have eternal life?
Yes, sir.
Let's read it again. And when he was gone forth into the way, that is Jesus.
There came one running.
That's the rich young ruler.
And kneeled to him.
And he asked him,
good master.
Read the question.
What shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?
What did Jesus tell him?
If thou wilt enter into life,
do what?
Keep the commandments.
So it's not just believing, it is also acting.
Oh, yes, preacher.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
For sure.
It is also acting. If you want to get into that life, Jesus says,
yes,
you must keep the commandments.
Amen.
You see, he had already been introduced to Jesus. He already believed in Jesus. But yet still in his mind and in his heart, he knew full well that something was missing. Jesus was teasing him. Jesus was trying to draw him out. Jesus was testing him. And so Jesus says, if you want to be saved, you are a Jew. You are a ruler of the Jews. You are a Pharisee. You are a member of the Sanhedrin. You know the law. If you want to be saved, keep the commandments. He asked Jesus, which ones? Jesus pointed to the 10. Huh? I want you to know tonight, the observance of the law is not a means of eternal life. It never was and never will be. It cannot perform that task. James says, the law is like a mirror that shows a man that his face is dirty. But the mirror cannot clean your face.
True.
The law tells you you are a sinner. The law tells you you need a savior. The law tells you you need grace. And then Jesus steps in and fulfills the law.
Amen.
And declares us righteous. That's how it works. That's how it works. The law, therefore, cannot justify anybody. It convicts men of sin. You're a liar. You're a thief. You're an adulterer. You're a fornicator. Huh? You covet. You break the Sabbath. That's the function of the law. It defines what sin is, but it cannot emancipate man from the sinner. It means then that we need a savior.
Hallelujah.
And that savior is Jesus.
Jesus.
It becomes clear then that the law is a standard for Christian behavior and Christian living.
Amen, preacher.
And if you are a Christian, you will keep the law. Not to be saved, but because you are in a saving relationship with Jesus. There isn't anybody who can claim to be in a safe relationship with Jesus and does not seek to obey what Jesus says. You think that Susanna Hall can tell me she loves me and runs around the place with other men?
No way.
Well, I'm not buying that.
No, sir.
Anybody's with me? You think I can tell my wife I love her and I'm putting my hand on her without love? Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Oh, yes, preacher.
So what you say must be commensurately matched by what you do.
Oh, yes.
If you say you love God and believe in Jesus, then Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments.
That's the
no woman would stay with a man who says he loves her and cruelly mistreats her.
True talk.
Because as we say in Barbados, your evening word and your morning word don't match. Your actions and your words don't match. Listen to this tonight. Romans tells us plainly that there's a relationship between law and grace that we must come to terms with. Romans 6, 14 and 15. What does that say, my brother?
What then?
Shall we do what?
Sin because we are not under the law?
We are not under the law, yes. We are saved by Jesus. Huh? But we are under grace. What does Paul say to that question?
Must we sin? Certainly not.
Certainly not. We establish the law. Grace is not an excuse for sin. James 2, 26 tells us, for as the body without the spirit is dead. Come on, everybody, finish it.
So faith without works is also dead.
So there's faith and then there is obedience.
Oh, yes, preacher.
Are you with me?
Yes.
The words on the U.S. money says, in God we trust.
We trust.
And I had a friend who used to say, all others must pay.
Must pay. Lazar Shesh.
In God we trust.
Come on, preacher.
All others must pay.
Pay.
So faith without works is dead.
Dead, preacher.
Even when you trust, you must obey. For the songwriter says, there is no other way.
Oh, yeah.
To be happy in Jesus. But to trust.
Trust.
And obey.
Obey, preacher.
So faith and works. Jesus died on the cross to bring us grace. And when he died on that cross, he nailed the handwriting of ordinances to the cross. Is anybody following me tonight?
Yes, preacher.
Now, I want to mention this on my way to resolving the question that leads me to shake my head. Now, God's law was written with his what, Brother Goring?
Finger.
And where did he write it? On tables of?
Stone.
But Moses' law, what the Bible refers to as Moses' law,
was not written on tables of stone.
No, sir.
Where was that written?
In a book.
And it was placed inside the ark.
For sure.
Are you listening to what I'm saying?
Clearly, preacher.
The tables of stone were separate and distinct from the laws, civil and moral and dietary and festivals and feasts. Is anybody hearing me tonight?
Yes, preacher.
A distinction is to be drawn between the Ten Commandments and the rest of the laws.
True, true.
The Ten Commandments are God's laws.
Oh, yes.
That he wrote with his finger and gave them to Moses. The civil laws, the criminal laws, the moral laws, the laws of order, of festivals and ceremonies are referred to in scripture as Moses' law.
Moses' law. Yes, sir.
Are you hearing me? The Bible says when Christ died, he nailed something to the cross. Paul calls it the handwriting contained in what? Brother Goring?
Ordinances.
What are ordinances? The law of commandments contained in ordinances.
Yes, sir.
Now we're going to go to Colossians 2:14 to understand this.
Yes.
And I'm not afraid of it because this is a passage that people quote to say that Seventh-day Adventists are wrong. But I'm going straight to it.
Oh, yes.
2 Corinthians 2, verse 14. Let's read together out loud, everybody. It says that Christ did what?
Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances.
Paul mentions that word again. The handwriting of ordinances.
Yes.
The laws of Moses that were written by his hand.
True, true.
And placed in the sanctuary. Christ blot them out.
Amen.
The Apostle Paul says they were against us.
Yes.
They were contrary to us.
Oh, yes.
And Christ took them
out of the way,
nailing them
to the cross.
Do you follow me tonight?
Yes, sir.
We're going a step further. Now, what are these laws? At the cross, the ceremonial system of sacrifices came to an end. We don't kill lambs anymore.
True.
The entire sanctuary service, all of the symbols in that service pointed to Jesus Christ.
Yes, sir.
Do you know that the lamb represented Jesus Christ?
Hallelujah.
Do you know the unleavened bread that did not have any yeast?
True.
No rising agent. Also represented Christ.
For sure.
Do you know that the priest represented Christ? Do you know that the blood that saved represented Christ? Do you know that the lampstand represented Jesus Christ, who is the light of the world?
Oh, yes.
Do you understand me tonight? All the symbols in the Old Testament sanctuary represented Christ. They were antitypical. They were symbols of something else that was to come. When I was a child, I thought as a child. I understood as a child. But when I became a man,
oh yes, preacher,
I put away childish things. Are you listening to me? The Bible says that we now have a better tabernacle, a better sanctuary.
Better sanctuary.
That is not made with hands.
True.
And we are looking for a better country.
Yes, sir.
Whose builder and maker is God.
Is God himself.
And we have a better high priest who can be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. And then Paul says, we have a better sacrifice.
Praise his name.
He says, the blood of lambs and bullocks could not attain for man's sins. But what they could not do, Jesus Christ came in the flesh and he paid it all for us.
Hallelujah.
All to him I owe.
Yes, sir.
Sinner, had left the crimson stain, but he washed it white as snow. The Old Testament sanctuary and its symbols are what Paul describes as ordinances.
True, preacher.
And he says, Paul says, Jesus nailed those to the cross.
Oh, yes. Nailed them.
It was not the Ten Commandments.
True.
And let me tell you how Jesus nailed it to the cross. Do you know that every day in the temple, in the sanctuary, people were led by the Spirit of God? That cloud, that pillar of cloud was Jesus Christ who led them. That pillar of fire was Jesus.
Yes.
Everything about the sanctuary was Christ. All of this pointed to Jesus. Paul says the blood of lambs cannot save us. But one day John the Baptist saw Jesus standing on the banks of the river Jordan. And he cried out, "Behold the Lamb of God."
Yes, sir.
Who does what?
Takes away the sin of the world.
Now the lamb in the sanctuary was part of the ordinance. But Jesus Christ was the real thing.
Absolutely.
And when he died, the veil in the temple was ripped from top
to bottom.
And the sanctuary services were abolished.
Amen.
They are nailed to the cross. They are nailed to the cross. Oh, how much are you listening to me? He was willing to bear. Without anguish or loss, Jesus went to the cross.
Yes, sir.
And he carried my sins with him there.
Praise his name.
Paul therefore concludes in Colossians 2:16. Adventists, come on, read it. Don't be afraid of it. Read it.
Let no man therefore judge you in meat.
Let no man judge you in what?
Meat.
Uh-huh.
Or in drink.
Uh-huh.
Or in respect of an holy day or of the new moon. Of the Sabbath days.
Now, there are many people who quote this text to say that Adventists are wrong. They say that we judge people concerning meat because you know how we are with health and food. They say we judge people concerning drink, alcohol, and so on. They say we judge people concerning holy days, new moons, Sabbath days, right? But remember, Paul, in this chapter, is talking about ordinances.
Ordinances, preacher.
When Paul says, "Let no man judge you in meat," Paul is talking about ordinances.
Context, yes.
And if you look at the Old Testament, Paul shortens it, meat, because he is talking to the Jews, and they understood what he was saying.
Oh, yes.
But in the Old Testament, it was called meat. Offerings.
That's it.
Drink offerings.
For sure.
Respect of holy days. Festivals were like bank holidays.
True, true.
Unleavened bread. Feast of trumpets. The waving of the first grain. All of these were holy days. Now, these are different from the Seventh-day Sabbath.
Oh, yes, for sure.
That comes every Saturday once per week. These festivals had dates attached to them. The 1st of Nisan.
Definitely.
The 15th of Nisan. The 7th day of the 10th month, etc. Now, when you put a date on it, it cannot be the same day every year.
True. True.
And that is the problem with what we call Good Friday.
True.
And Easter Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
Because the date on which Christ died cannot always be a Friday every year.
True. Strong point, preacher.
Are you understanding what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
My birth date is October the 8th. Any Octobarians in the house?
Raise your hands.
Bless up, wherever you are. For real. Word. I hang out with the young people sometimes. Now watch me.
I was born 19 long ago.
Long ago, a preacher.
On a Saturday morning.
Okay, yes, sir.
This is what my mother said. There was just she and I. There was no doctor. He had not yet come. The midwife was busy with something else. And mom and I decided we were going to handle this ourselves.
Come on, preacher, tell us.
Are you listening to what I'm saying? And when the medical people came, there was I. Already out. This is what I heard. This is the story I was told. Listen to me.
Yes, sir.
But that day was a Saturday. When I turn one, my birthday will not be a Saturday.
True.
It will be what? Next year, Monday. Next year, Tuesday.
Yes.
Are you with me?
We
but
you
every year is Good Friday.
Mercy.
Is anybody hearing me?
You're on point, preacher.
Are you hearing what I'm not saying? Let's move on. Paul says that these festivals with dates, sometimes they did not occur on a Saturday. They occurred on a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. These are festivals.
Yes.
These are Jewish feasts.
Yes.
These are ordinances. They are separate and distinct from the commandments and from the seventh-day Sabbath. And Paul calls them ordinances. And Paul says Jesus took them out of the way because they were against us.
Amen.
He ends, my brother, in verse 17. What does he say?
Which are a shadow of things to come.
Now, the ordinances were shadows of things to come.
Yes.
Not the commandments. Because they were there before.
Oh, yes.
It is the Jewish feast and festivals and the killing of lambs. The priesthood. All of that were a shadow of things to come.
Yes.
Because now, Jesus is our priest.
Hallelujah.
Jesus is our lamb.
Praise his name.
Are you listening to what I'm saying?
Yes.
Jesus is the bread of life. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. Jesus is all the world to me. My life. My all.
Come on, preacher.
Are you listening to what I'm saying? We don't need anything else. But Jesus Christ, he fulfills all the law. Are you hearing me tonight? I gotta hurry on. Now, the rich young ruler said to Jesus, what must I do? And Jesus said, keep the commandments. He was not referencing the feast. He meant the 10. The young man said to him, which? Jesus says, don't murder, don't steal, don't commit adultery. Remember I showed you that?
Yes.
And then the young man says to Jesus, brother, go in, what he tell Jesus?
All these things have I kept from my youth up. What lack I yet?
I believe him. I believe him as I believe some of y'all Seventh-day Adventists up in here. You are good at keeping commandments. You have no gross sin. You've never been to prison. You've never raped. You've never robbed a bank. You keep the Sabbath. You have one wife. You are faithful. We may well say, we have been doing these things from our youth up. Even though we don't do them perfectly, we can say that. And this is what the man was saying. He did not understand that obedience to rules by themselves are not a recipe for salvation.
True.
Unless a person is ashamed of sin, there is no salvation. He did not know that a man may be free from gross sin and yet come short of the grace and glory of God. He did not know that hands may be clean from external pollutions
and yet he may perish eternally because his heart is wicked.
True, true.
He did not know that you don't need to have sex with the woman. You just have to think about it. And you're an adulterer. So he said to Jesus, I've been doing all this. And then he asked Jesus the question. All these I have done from my youth. What else now do I have to do? Listen to Ellen White commenting on this rich young ruler. Read with me, allegory. What does it say?
Christ read the ruler's heart.
Everybody else say amen. Read out loud with the reader, please. Let's go.
He needed the love of God in his soul.
Yes.
This lack, unless supplied,
would
prove fatal.
His whole nature
would become corrupted.
That he might receive the love of God.
His supreme love of self must be surrendered.
So do you understand what I'm saying tonight? It was not about the laws. It was about his heart.
True.
And his heart was filled with being rich, being young, and being ruler. In other words, he put these things before God.
True.
Let's continue to read. Christ called upon him to choose between what?
Heavenly treasure.
And worldly?
Greatness.
Is that the call that is coming to somebody here tonight? Choose heavenly treasure over worldly greatness?
True.
My daughter said something to me many years ago. And it hurt me to the core. And then I thought about it for a while and it inspired me. And I do not blame her. She knows that I love her. She's probably watching now. Suthani, we love you. And I've told this illustration before in her presence, so she knows what I'm talking about. My child looked at me and complimented me and then canceled it out in the next part of the sentence. It was never so great a compliment and never so great a pain. Barry, you know what she said to me? She said, Daddy, you are one of the smartest persons I know. And I started to smile. She said, you could be somebody great if you weren't so religious.
Mercy.
Tell me you understand what I just said. My daughter says, Daddy, I've looked at your brain, I've seen, I've heard you speak, I know how good you are. But if it wasn't for your commitment to church, you could be somebody great.
Tell us, preacher.
And I thought about it. And I realized she was right. Are you hearing me?
Yes, preacher.
But then it inspired me when God showed me. God doesn't need bright people in the church.
No, sir.
The people in the church must be dullards. Is it only the government and the private sector that needs intelligent people?
No, sir.
Don't we do that with our children?
True.
When they pass for big school, with big name and big pedigree, we send them because God church school not good enough.
Come on, preacher.
I'm talking about the people in Barbados.
Dominica, preacher.
They do that here too?
Oh, yes, preacher.
They send them to the primary schools, ours. But then they pass for Queen's Royal College. Oh. What is the big school here? Huh? Convent. We have a lot of names in Barbados. Once they pass, we send them. They are too good for God. And God showed me that I need to turn the thing on top of my head. And there's nobody here doubting my daughter. There's nobody here doubting her. If it weren't for my connection to the church, I could be somebody great. But you know what God showed me? I greater than all them.
Come on, preacher. Mount up, evangelist. Go ahead now.
I went to school with half the politicians in Barbados. Same school. When I was there, my goal was to become an attorney, become a politician. I wanted to rule the country. I wanted to be the prime minister. That was my goal in life. And my daughter knows it and sees it and says, "Were it not for this Jesus thing,
mercy."
But I want people in here to know tonight.
Come on, preacher.
There is nothing greater than working for God.
Hallelujah to the Lamb of God.
Are you hearing me tonight? Well, after I began to work for God, I did go back and become a lawyer. I think you know that. And most of my law practice, almost all of it, is for members of the church.
Amen.
Especially as it relates to religious freedom. When people cannot work because they're Sabbath keepers. When people cannot get a fair break because people are prejudiced against them since they're Adventists. I go down to the courts every now and then and I talk with the judges and the magistrates and argue with the lawyers and win.
Amen. Praise his name.
I don't know if you're hearing me. I'm not bragging. I'm trying to tell you I've lost nothing for becoming a pastor.
Strong word, preacher.
I was in Jamaica as a student. I was a student of the law school, had not graduated yet, was in my final year. And we had to present arguments in a mock trial before a real judge. And at that trial, when I was done presenting Barry, the judge looked at me and said, "Hall, what were you doing before you came to law?" I think I may have told you about it here. I said to him, "Sir, I was in the soul business." He said, "Soul business?" I said, "Yeah, I used to fix shoes." He said to me, "Certainly, certainly, Mr. Hall, you jest." I said, "Yes, my Lord, I jest. You caught me." I said, "Sir, I'm a preacher." And a judge of 15 years looked me in the eye and said, "No, not you. A preacher could not have represented himself the way I saw you representing yourself this afternoon." He said, "I have been on this bench for 15 years, and you are better than many attorneys who have been there just as long."
Amen.
I have not lost nothing.
Amen, preacher.
For being a Jesus boy.
Yes, sir.
In fact, I've gained Europe.
Praise his name.
Africa. Israel.
Hallelujah.
Are you listening to me? Because of this church. Because of this church. Let me finish it. We got to close. Christ called upon him to choose between what? Heavenly treasure and worldly greatness. Self must yield. His will must be given unto Christ to control, but he must take up the cross. Do what else?
And follow the Savior.
In the path of
self-denial.
Listen to this. But then the young man heard that saying, "Sell what you have and give to poor."
Yes, sir.
The Bible says what?
He went away sorrowful.
For he had what?
Great possessions.
Now watch this. The ruler was quick to discern all that Christ's words involved. Became sad. He was a member of the honored council of the Jews, and Satan was tempting him with flattering prospects for his future. Do you get that?
Yes.
Listen to Ellen White. He wanted the heavenly treasure, but he wanted also the advantages of his riches would bring him. He desired eternal life, but the sacrifice was too great, and he went away sorrowful.
Yes, preacher.
Why?
For he had great possessions.
For he had great possessions. Now, I want to say to the church as I come to a close tonight, anything we put before Jesus Christ, we're going to lose it.
Yes.
Including our lives.
Yes, sir.
The young man went away shaking his head.
it was too much for him to handle. The sacrifice was too great. And I read this and I also shake my head. How could a person see the grace and mercy and tenderness and love and provisions and protections and guidance and leadership and blessings of God and turn their backs and walk away? Because it cost them too much. I ask you tonight as I get ready to close, praise team, you can come. What is keeping you from surrendering everything to Jesus? There's somebody in here tonight. For you, it's gambling. For somebody else, it's drugs. For somebody, it's money. For somebody, it's fame. For somebody, it's worldly pleasures. I ask you tonight, is there anything worth your soul's salvation to keep you away from God? It's called delayed gratification. We must have patience and wait. God is going to give us the gold. God is going to give us the silver. God is going to give us the riches. But not here, not yet, not now. Tonight I'm calling. This call tonight will not be long. It will be very brief, in fact. If you believe that nothing must stand between you and Jesus, raise your hands tonight. If you really believe that, stand with me, please. Stand with me. Stand with me. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. I'm not belaboring this call tonight. I'm very simple. All those who are going to commit tonight, whoever you are, however how long you've been in church, Pastor, I do not want anything to stand between me and Jesus. I am surrendering it all. If that's you, come to the altar. Let's pray tonight. Keep on coming. Hear my cry. And while on others thou art calling. Savior, do not pass me.
Do not pass me by.
Sing, Savior.
Savior.
Somebody sing, Savior.
Savior.
Tell him, hear my cry.
Hear my humble cry.
And while on others,
while on others
in the back tent, if you want that close walk with Christ, come on up.
Do not pass me by.
We are not playing any games tonight. What must I do to have eternal life? You have to surrender all. All. Do not keep any back. The rich young ruler could not do it. It was too much. He had too much money. Couldn't give it up. What is it for you tonight? Too much worldly pleasure, too much fame, too much comfort, too much ease? Is it friends that will laugh at you or scorn you? Is it family members that will criticize you? Is it a church that you've been a member of that you feel you cannot leave? What is it? Is it a husband? Is it a wife? Is it a girlfriend or a boyfriend? What are you placing in front of God tonight? Leave it all. Leave it all for God's dear name. I'm not prolonging it. If you've decided tonight that you're going to leave all, you're going to leave all. And you are saying, Pastor, I have decided. I didn't decide before, but I'm deciding tonight. that I'm going to join the baptism on Sabbath. I'm going to give all. I'm going to give all. Is there anybody like that tonight who has decided? You didn't come before, but you want to come now? Raise your hand where you are. I'll see it. I'll see it. Hallelujah. There's one. Come, sweetheart, give me your hand. And give Jesus your heart. Come on up. Come on up. Praise the Lord. Is there anybody else here tonight? Come, my friend. Come, my friend. Savior. Is there anybody else? Come. 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 Why, Lord, of us? Let him through, please. Let him pass, please. Do not pass me. Come on. Is there anybody else tonight? You've decided. You've decided. I'm not going on much longer. I'm going to stop very soon. If you're coming, come now. If you're coming, come now. Jesus is calling. Kneeling there in sweet contrition. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Help my unbelief. Sing, Savior. Savior. Elders, pastors, can we get a little more help? Can we get a little help? Names. Give everybody a card. And while all of us, thou art calling. Somebody sing hallelujah. Let's stop right there. I'm ready to pray. I'm ready to pray. Before I say that prayer, you can come tonight. There's somebody here tonight who needs to return to Jesus. You've been here before. You've been with Jesus. You left. You need to return. You need to return. I'm holding it open for somebody, 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 somebody tonight. Who's coming? We're not going to do any more singing. I'm done with the singing tonight. But I'm asking, is there one more person, another person who wants to come? The baptism is this Sabbath. You've been already, sweetheart, I believe. You're washed. I don't want to stop you, man. If you want to come up here, you can come. If you want to come, come, baby. She wants you to come with her, come. She's already baptized last Sabbath, but she wants to come. Let her come. Let her come. Let her come. Hallelujah. Who else is coming? Anybody else? Anybody else? I'm not singing again tonight. I'm just calling. No singing, no singing. Keep playing for us, Barry. Hallelujah tonight. Parents, come with your children. Boyfriends, come with your girlfriends. Husbands, come with your wives. Come with your wives. Somebody say hallelujah. God is preparing people for this Sabbath. And I know he's going to do it. He knows he's going to do it. One more tonight. One more. One more. Is there one more? Is there one more? Hallelujah. Is there one more? Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God.
Do not pass me by.
Heavenly Father, tonight, Lord, I don't understand what you do or how you do it. But I thank you tonight for moving in men's lives. You are preparing people for your kingdom. And we thank you for calling these few out. Lord, accept
their commitment tonight, we pray. Bless them. Save them. Keep them in the mighty hollow of your hand. And Father, tonight, for others who have not come, I am still praying. A man, a woman, a boy, a girl, who used to know you closely, but has walked away. Lord, bring them back tonight. Lord, somebody who is wrestling against the stately steppings of the Spirit, they feel the Spirit moving. You have said to them, the preacher is right. The things he is reading from the Scripture are correct. You've moved upon their hearts and they've seen it for themselves. But Lord, they're stubborn and they're holding out. Tonight, oh Lord, break down these walls of stubbornness. Set your people free, oh Jesus. Give them a clear path to come to you. I'm praying, Lord, for that woman, that man, who is struggling right now with the decision. Lord, prepare them. Lord, save them. Lord, draw them. Remove all obstacles, all objections, all barriers. And let them come. Hallelujah. We thank you. We praise you. We magnify you tonight, oh God. And we claim these souls right now. They don't know yet that they'll be in the water this Sabbath. But we claim them now, oh God. By faith. By faith. By faith. In the name of the Father, Son, and Spirit. Now we say, go in peace, for God the Father loves you. Go in peace, for God the Son died to save you. Go in peace, for God the Holy Spirit is in you and with you to guide you. Go there, church. In peace. Get home safely, everybody. Tomorrow night's topic, I identify. Let's be here on time, and may God bless you real good. In Jesus' name. Praise team, the farewell song.
rejoice to see the fountain in his stead.
Good God.
And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away.
Wash all my sins.
Wash all my sins away.
Wash all. Oh.
Welcome to Homes of Hope and Healing Evangelistic Campaign. We are thrilled that you are here. Here are a few guidelines.